continue, I want you to think about this. As men and women of God, your life has to be a life of prayer. Your life has to be one of intimacy with God. This is powerful. You need to realize that on the strength of your intimacy with God, things are going to happen in this earth. Your ability to have the mind of Christ, your ability to know and sense what God is doing at that time will make it easier for you to flow and to do some things because you know you got the Spirit of the Lord's permission to do it. This is powerful. When you are connected, the fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. I want you to think about this. You have, when you have influence with God, you have a lot. So, the devil would have you to be more preoccupied with stuff that does not matter than the things that does. Because the worst case scenario, whenever you're dealing with a problem, you're going to need God's help anyway. So, don't wait till a time of crisis to get on your knees and pray. Learn how to develop an intimate relationship with the Lord. And everything doesn't have to be formal. You can do a lot of things as you're walking around prayerfully, acknowledging the Lord, as the scripture says. In all of our ways, we acknowledge him. He'll do what? He'll direct our pathway. And that's it. And that includes how to appropriate his authority and power. And you can know that you have the permission of God when there's intimacy. When you can sense these things, this is important. So let's lay the foundation for this. This is powerful, y'all. Hallelujah. Let's go to James chapter 5. James chapter 5, we're going to start at verse number 13. Hallelujah. All right. Let's deal with this thought. It says, is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing songs. Is any sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray. Is that word pray again? Pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another. Here's that word pray again. That you may be healed. That's powerful, y'all. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Now he gives an illustration. Elias, or Elijah, was a man subject to like passions as we are. And he prayed earnestly that it might not rain. And it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. So, the scripture talks about Elijah. Of all the people, James uses Elijah. And he talks about the intimacy. And he talks about Elijah praying earnestly that it might not rain. So it gives you an indication that he had... Now, let me explain this. We're talking about an illustration when we go to the First Kings, I believe it is chapter 17, where Elijah comes on the scene. This gives an illustration of what was going on before he stands before, Ahab, and declaring what he declares, saying that it would not rain, and it did not rain for the space of 3.5 years. We're going to tie this together to something very important, because as we leave the scripture, I want you to understand that James, the writer, is talking to us, and he compares us to how things can be for us, because he gives the illustration of Elijah and how he prayed earnestly. It says the fervent, effectual prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So it gives us the indication that we can use this, that this can apply to our lives. That's powerful, y'all. All right, let's tie this together. Let's keep on going. Let's go to 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter 17. Now, keep an open mind as we read this. And it says, and Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, that's powerful, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. Now you have to either be hearing from God, have confidence that God's going to stand behind you because of the authority that's been delegated to you, or you're just crazy. We choose to believe that somewhere in the middle, that he had permission from God to do these things, because again, God answered it. And I'm going to then as we read the verse below that, watch this. It says, and the word of the Lord came unto him saying, all right. So remember what we read in James. He said he prayed earnestly that it would not rain. There was nothing that was said that he got a revelation from God that it was not going to rain, because it would mean we would believe that it would say so. So when we see 1 Kings chapter 17, he says according to his word. So we understand relationship has its benefits. Because then in verse number 2, it says, and the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, get thee hence and turn thee eastward, and hide thyself by the brook of Cherith that is before Jordan. Now let's deal with this. We understand that everything that happened in those days may not necessarily have been recorded. I understand that. And you could probably surmise that maybe God, that in an interaction, God, no telling what God said, but based upon what we read, we would tend to believe that he prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and God gave him permission. All right, so let's deal with that. All right, so again we see an illustration where the Lord came to him and spoke to him concerning something particular about the posture that he was supposed to take as he made this decree, and what he would, and part of what he was going to be doing over 3.5 years. So we understand. Now, when we go back to James chapter 5, we understand that James says about Elijah that he's a man of like passions, like as we are. But yet he was able to decree some things. So we understand. So when you look at it in that context, it's given an illustration that Elijah had authority to decree that it would not rain, saying that the fervent, effectual prayer of a righteous man availeth much. That's powerful. Now, where do you find yourself in that? As a minister of the gospel, as a son and daughter of God, God has given you authority. Now, remember, our mandate is to change the environment where we are, to go in to Satan's dominion and make it the kingdom dominion, the kingdom of God's dominion. It's our job to come into this realm based upon the authority and relationship that God's given us as kingdom people, and to walk in these things. We have the power to decree some things and to declare some things. One man spoke a word, and for 3.5 years, it did not rain. One man was able to pretty much bring a nation to its knees. One man. Now, I want to reemphasize this. This was under the old covenant, and the new covenant is supposed to be better promises. So if under the old covenant, Elijah was able to speak those things and cause a supernatural event to take place, how much more under the New Testament, better promises, and the Spirit of God living on the inside of us, how much more power and authority can we walk in? And it's important for us to establish this, because we want you to know the authority that the Bible gives us. The Word of God gives us, the relationship with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ gives us within this three-dimensional realm. Now, I'm going to throw some other stuff in there for good measure. Hallelujah. Now, we could talk about Elijah raining down fire with the prophets of Baal. You know that story. All right. Fire came down and validated the situation. But we're going to talk about something else in 2 Kings chapter 1. Let's go to 2 Kings chapter 1. Now, I want you to understand something, because the Bible says faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the Word of God. We want to be to a place that as we talk about these things, that revelation will start to unfold in your life, and that you can see things as an opportunity rather than an obstacle. Now, I want you to hear this. Now, remember the times of old. For those of you that remember, we used to say class is in session, right? Say we're having lab, right? So we're taking the time to bring forth Holy Ghost teaching that will cause you to look to the power of God, because there's enough people with intellect. We have enough of that. But nothing has changed. Let's deal with the bottom line. Hallelujah. Nothing has changed. We may see some things happening within the local body, but God wants to mobilize his people to affect in regions, to have dominion. That's what kingdom does. You take dominion over an area. You don't compromise. You don't try to pattern yourself to what's going on. I want you to understand, you run this. God's given you authority. So let's tie this together in a nice little bow like only the Holy Ghost can. 2 Kings chapter 1. And we're going to start at verse number 1 because I think it's relevant. It says, then Moab rebelled against Israel after the death of Ahab. And Ahaziah fell down through a lattice in his upper chamber that was in Samaria and was sick. And he sent messengers and said unto them, go inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron, whether I shall recover of this disease. That's kind of like what people do today. They pray to another god. But the angel of the Lord said to Elijah the Tishbite, arise, go up to meet the messengers of the king of Samaria, and say unto them, is it not because there is not a god in Israel that you go inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron? No. So let's keep on going. Now therefore, thus saith the Lord, thou shalt not come down from that bed on which thou art gone up, but thou shalt surely die. And Elijah departed. That's the word of the Lord. That's powerful. Now that was under the old covenant now, but how much more under the New Testament did the powers have power? Now, we will deal with prophecy under the New Testament. We understand those things. But I want to illustrate a point here. And when the messengers turned back unto him, he said unto them, why are you now turned back? And they said unto him, there came a man up to meet us and said unto us, go turn again unto the king that sent you and say unto him, thus saith the Lord, is it not because there is not a God in Israel that thou sendest to inquire Beelzebub, the god of Ekron? Therefore thou shalt not come down from that bed on which thou art gone up, but shalt surely die. And he said unto them, what manner of man was he which came up to meet you and told you these words? And they answered him, he was a hairy man and girt with a girdle of leather about his loins. And he said, it is Elijah the Tishbite. Now watch this. Then the king sent unto him a captain of 50 and his 50. And he went up to him, and behold, he sat on the top of a hill. Now this is Elijah on the top of the hill. He spake unto him, thou man of God, the king hath said, come down. Now watch what happens now. And Elijah answered and said to the captain of the 50, if I be a man of God, then let fire come down from heaven and consume thee and thy 50. And there came down fire from heaven and consumed him and his 50. That's powerful. Under the Old Testament. Let's keep reading. Again also he sent unto him another captain of 50 with his 50. And he answered and said unto him, O man of God, thus hath the king said, come down quickly. Now, when you read the backdrop, they was basically disrespecting Elijah. And they wasn't coming to sip tea. They was coming to do something to Elijah. All right. Verse 12. And Elijah answered and said unto him, if I be a man of God, let fire come down from heaven and consume thee and thy 50. And the fire of God came down from heaven. Now it's the fire of God now. Came down from heaven and consumed him and his 50. Verse 13. It's powerful. Are you getting a point? Divine protection. All right? And he sent again a captain of the third 50 with his 50. Now by then, this third captain had a change of heart. And the third captain of the 50 went up and came and fell on his knees before Elijah and besought him. And said unto him, O man of God, I pray thee, let my life and the life of these fifty thy servants be precious in thy sight. Behold, there came fire down from heaven and burnt up the two captains of the former 50s with their 50s. Therefore, let my life now be precious in thy sight. That's power. That's dominion. An angel of the Lord said unto Elijah, go down with him. Be not afraid of him. That's powerful. I want you to hear me. We have an awesome covenant, y'all. And he arose and went down with him unto the king. And he said unto him, for thus saith the Lord, for as much as thou hast sent messengers to inquire of Beelzebub, the god of Ekron, is it not because there is no god in Israel to inquire of his word? Therefore thou shalt not come down off that bed on which thou art gone up, but shalt surely die. Verse 17, so he died according to the word of the Lord, which Elijah had spoken. And Jehoram reigned in his stead in the second year of Jehoram, the son of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, because he had no son. That is powerful. I want you to understand something. Relationship has its benefits. Now, I'm not saying that, listen now, somebody may say, well, should we go around calling down fire from heaven all the time? You make that distinction. You make that distinction. All I'm trying to do is tell you that the scripture in James gives us an illustration of Elijah as a man of like passions as we are, and understanding the power of relationship. And that's what God wants to do in this day. God wants to bring relationship to a supernatural realm where you can start to walk into things. Now, we've given illustrations of some of the things that Jesus did. He was able to rebuke the storm. He was able to curse the fig tree, and it was gone. These are not just metaphors. These are actual accounts of Bible facts. Hallelujah. Now, either the word of God is true or it's not, but for us it's true. So we're just going to simply, we're not going to make this complicated. We're going to take the word of God for what it is. Now, we're going to give one more scripture in St. Luke chapter 9. And we're going to tie this all together. St. Luke chapter 9, real quick. Hallelujah. We're going to start at verse number 51, I believe it is. St. Luke chapter 9, starting at verse number 51. Now watch this. And it came to pass when the time was come that he should be received up. In other words, he's getting ready to be crucified. He steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem. Now this is key to this passage. And he sent messengers before his face. And they went and entered into the village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. And they did not receive him because his face was as though he would go to Jerusalem. When you read other translations, the intention was for him to keep was him to go beyond that point. I mean you can play with that, but it's telling you the reason why he was not received. All right, watch this. And when his disciples James and John saw this, they said, Lord, wilt thou that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elijah did? But he turned and rebuked them and said, you know not what manner of spirit you are. So I'm giving you an answer whether you should be calling fire down on heaven for every situation. All right. For the Son of Man has not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. And they went to another village. Now, I want you to understand something. I want you to hear something. This is what the Lord did not say. The Lord did not say it was not possible. He told them that they was operating in the wrong spirit for the time and the place. Now, when we read verse 51, the goal was to get to Jerusalem. That was the goal. And you see, the people at that particular time that refused the disciples were not in no way hindering the plan of God at all. That's a whole different scenario. They was not hindering the plan of God because Jesus' face was set to go to Jerusalem. Different situation. Elijah's life was on the line when he called fire down from heaven. They was coming. They wasn't coming to sip tea. They was coming to take him. And God knows what they was trying to do. So that we understand the scenarios is different. But when you walk with intimacy with God, you can know the time and the place. You got to understand something about the disciples. They was not in the place to understand spiritual activity and understand the times, because when you read the scriptures, many times Jesus tried to teach them things and they were slow in picking it up. They did not understand what was going on at a particular time. So I mean, they had knowledge of what had happened in the book of Kings. But again, the situation was not one that warranted that. All right. Even when Jesus was getting ready to be taken, he had the power, if he wanted to call down 12 legions of angels. And then we also read one more translation that when they came, he spoke and said, I am he, and they all fell back. That's power. That's authority. So we understand something. Jesus did not have to be taken if he did not want to. And Jesus could have handled the situation any way he wanted to, but he was on a divine assignment. All right, so we want to establish that. We want you to understand something. Jesus did not say it could not be done. He just told them they was operating in the wrong spirit. And with the parameters of everything we've just discussed, it was not a situation. The goal was to get to Jerusalem. Jesus' life was not on the line because a few people refused him right there. So let's deal with that. Let's deal with the bottom line. Everything in the scriptures is for our learning. Now, it is true that because we have the Spirit of God on the inside of us, we need to properly appropriate that and understand the times and place and seasons. This is where intimacy comes in. You need to know when you have the permission of God to say things and do things. It goes back to what I said before. You need to know when God has given you the authority to act in a certain realm. And the thing that's going to fix that is intimacy. Now, again, let's deal with this, and we're getting ready to close it down. Just because a person's a dynamic speaker don't mean that they have power and authority. Some of the driest people you can meet as far as speaking have power and authority. So it's not about that. It can be, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. Intimacy speaks in the end. Your intimacy with God will speak beyond your grandiose words, beyond your excitement, beyond your demeanor, beyond your eloquence. Authority with God will speak, and just like we've said this before, and I say it again, demons recognize spiritual authority, and the elements recognize spiritual authority. So we're tying this together right now. We declare that you grow in relationship. Your prayer life has to be a foundation for everything that you do. Your prayer life will even help you understand the word with a much clearer perspective. Because we have the Spirit of God on the inside of us, but we have to have interaction with the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. We need to have interaction. This is going to create a powerful situation. Now remember, God's given you the authority to change the atmosphere where you live. This is your opportunity. I want you to grow in grace. We release a fresh anointing over you right now. We release the supernatural power over you. We pray that God give you a heavenly visitation, that God will show you what you have access to in the kingdom. The authority that you have access to as a good minister in Christ, as a son and daughter of the Most High, as a citizen of the kingdom. We declare that over your life right now. We release heaven on earth where you are. We declare God's ridiculous favor in your life in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. This is our segment for this hour. We'll be talking to you again real soon. God bless you. Give them heaven on earth where you are, where you're listening. We love you. Talk to you soon. You